Well, the time has come to finally talk about this. You knew it was coming sooner or later. Star Fox Adventures. Not exactly a Star Fox game in the way most people think about it, because you want to usually just fly around in the R-Wing, but that doesn't happen in this. Same thing with Star Fox Assault, at least there you get to fly the ship a little bit more, but whatever. Anyway, so what we have here is a Star Fox game that originally wasn't supposed to be a Star Fox game. For those of you who don't know, this was originally supposed to be a game called Dinosaur Planet. Yeah, they say that in the game too. But it was supposed to be on the game, not the GameCube, it was supposed to be on the N64. And then they moved it over to the GameCube for whatever reason. That one's not exactly clear. In fact, it's actually possible to hear a line of dialogue that was kept in from Dinosaur Planet towards the very beginning when you see General Scales on the ship. But yeah. Other than that, the game was originally supposed to look pretty much exactly the same. It would even have the warp stone Scottish guy and all that. It was going to have a lot of talking, And you didn't play as Star Fox, obviously. You played as the Blue Fox person. What was her name? Crystal. So that's the reason for that. I figured I explained. So that's why this is a Star Fox game when they did make it, when it originally wasn't supposed to be. Oh well. It's kind of like Smash Brothers. That's the same way when that was originally created. It wasn't supposed to have Nintendo characters in it, and then they had the idea to put the Nintendo characters in it, and obviously that became very popular, so they continued to do it. But whatever. If you want to know more about it, the little bit less, the more there is, just watch Yuri of Wind. He did the video on both of those. There's even less about the original Smash Brothers game. I keep messing up what I'm saying. Anyway, back to this. The story of this is Crystal, she's a defender of this, or protector of this planet called Dinosaur Planet, obviously. Scepter playing a big role in that, and the Crozoa spirits in the Crozoa Palace. And General Scales wants to screw things up. He wants to take control for himself, as is usual for many villains in games and movies and so on and so forth. And basically gets entrapped, and Star Fox comes by, gets contracted to help Dinosaur Planet, or find out what's going on, and goes down there, finds out that the planet's regions, like basically the continents, have been ejected off of the planet itself and are floating in space, and he has to reattach them basically. I'm kind of summarizing what they say in the game itself for what it is. And so he has to do that and help out, and meets the queen of the Earthwalker tribe, which is basically the ruler of the whole place overall. And then you also meet her son, Prince Tricky, who becomes kind of like your sidekick throughout the game. Really is more, this character can only do certain things that you can't. You have to use them throughout the game, and you have to find all the Crozoa spirits, replace all the continents that have been ejected off into the space on the planet, and stop General Scales. Basically, is the overall idea of the game. It's an action adventure game, but the only times you actually get to fly in the R-Wing are when you're traveling from the different places on the planet, or that used to be on the planet, and when you first in the game, when you first go there. You just have to fly through a certain number of gold rings. It tells you avoid dying, shooting some stuff, and you can get it still counts score though, like it did in the old Star Fox games, which there really isn't that many. I mean, there's that one that was finished and never released, Star Fox 2, but whatever. And then you land wherever you are, and you have to have fuel cells. That's kind of a pain in the ass, but they're not that hard to get, and it's better to find them than to buy them. I'll get to that. As you play the game, you get different abilities. You can upgrade for the staff. You never get to use his blaster gun. In fact, they actually pretty much right in the beginning talk about that and why you can't do it. It's a lame contrivance. So you're basically stuck slapping around these. This is pretty much your main enemy in the game. Slight variations of what they look like, and you're smacking around with the staff. So that's about it. You can't jump, by the way, on your own. You can only jump if you walk off of a ledge. Auto jumps, kind of like in Die Hard Vendetta, but you can roll, you can defend when you hit R with the staff, and so on and so forth. The combat's extremely simple. In fact, it's a lot like another game, which is what this is always compared to, and I can see the comparison now that I've played a few and I've beaten one, is Zelda. That's basically what this is. This game pretty much plays like a Zelda game, and a lot of people took issue with that, not because they don't like Zelda, but because that's not what they wanted from a Star Fox game. Especially since Rare made this. They're the ones that, they know how to make Star Fox, because they're the ones that did. Star Fox Assault was a little bit better than that, like I said, because there's more spaceship flying shooting, but as soon as you get to the on foot stuff, it falls apart. The game's got some other issues in that. It wasn't made by Rare either, and it shows. But that's that game. Whenever I get that, if I get that, then I'll deal with it then. As far as the rest goes, you go to different areas. They're different enough. You have one of the early ones you go to is like a ice tundra place. It's kind of like Spyro in a way, in many ways, and many ways not. Like I said, most of the time you're on foot and you're doing stuff like that, and it does do a lot of different stuff when you're there. You have to do things, you have to solve things, you have to find things, and you have to talk to characters, but that's really simple. It's not like you have multiple, dialogue trees or anything like in Knights of the Old Republic. And you use different items. Sometimes you go find stuff. It's not that clear where you gotta find things. There's a shop where you have to use scarabs as your money current, your currency, to buy things. Sometimes optional, sometimes not optional. What's a pain in the ass with that is you actually are limited how many scarabs you can carry at first until you find this one woolly mammoth that gives you a scarab bag, which increases your capacity to 50. You can only carry like 20. And it's still annoying when you get the 51 because there's one bigger than that and lets you carry 150. So basically, it not so much punishes you, but it prevents you for no right reason of buying some of the higher end, buy better stuff. It's lame, to be honest. And you have to go quite a while before you get the big scarab bag, but whatever. So you go through, you talk to certain characters, they give you kind of objectives you have to do for different things. Find this person, do this, replace this. Find this item for me. Typical stuff usual like that. It's kind of like Metroid Prime in a way, in that way too. But it's a lot less involved. Where Metroid Prime got it good was it, you could figure out where you're going on your own most of the time, even without using the map or even without telling you what to do. It's kind of obvious. In this game, sometimes you get kind of confused as what you're supposed to do, where you're supposed to go. It doesn't happen that often, but it happens enough that it's a problem, really. As far as the rest and other things, combat is very simplistic. It does get repetitive after a while. I mean, all you do is wait for an opening in the enemy and just keep smacking around, and then the worst thing that happens is they get knocked down the ground and you can't really hit them. And you gotta wait for them to stand back up. And they'll just keep blocking you until you break their block, which is next to impossible unless you use magic. Or you just block yourself and then wait for them to hit you, then they bounce off and then they. That's your opening to attack. As far as magic goes, you get a few spells. Takes a while to get each of them. One of them is really not an offensive spell. It's used to like jump up. You stick your staff in the ground and kind of rockets you up. The first one you get is like fireball, just using as an example. You have a bar that's for magic. You can increase that by finding the hidden places that upgrade your stuff like that, and you get new spells. And the only way you can replenish your meter for that is whacking these plants that have these gems that replenish it. It's not that bad of a problem, but it does get annoying sometimes when you forget to do that. It's better to just use your regular melee attack with a staff because a lot of times you actually have to use magic to open doors and all. You have to shoot these little red squares, and if you don't have any magic and you can't find any of the plants around, you're kind of screwed. There's that. The other thing is with the AI of the psychic tricky I mentioned. It's hit and miss. Sometimes it does what it wants, and sometimes it doesn't do what you want it to do. It's a lot like the AI in Resident Evil 5 when you're trying to tell Chev or Chris to do something and they don't want to do it. You have to feed him these blue mushrooms, so you have to go collect those, and it's annoying during the day. The game has day and night cycles, by the way. They sleep at night, so it makes it easier to get up close to them and whack them to collect them. But during the day, they run away fast, and you have to go chase them. It's more bullshit than it has to be. It should be. And every time you give him an action to do, basically, like if you tell him to breathe fire, dig, or do whatever, except for if you tell him to heal and come to you, those don't take up the blue mushroom meter, I guess you would call it, food meter, then it takes a few away, and if it runs low enough, he just won't do anything. Even when it's full, sometimes he just won't do anything. He's just, I'm not gonna. And it gets annoying. But it's the way the game is. You have to get used to it, and you have to use him. You're forced to. Enough about that kind of stuff. There really isn't much else to talk about. Going on about the other stuff. Visually, the game looks very good. It still does to this day. They put a lot of effort into it. It shows that Rare made use of the GameCube and what it could do, its hardware. It's very nice looking. It's very colorful, of course, but beyond that, I mean, if you look at Fox himself, just use an example, and sometimes when it's really close up, close enough, obviously, you can see. Like you look at his tail or even his face, you can see it's like almost like they have individual like little hair sticking out. It's really impressive, considering when this was made. I mean, there's not even on the computer some exclusive stuff on that. Unless it's something like The Witcher, you're really not going to get that much detail, you know? I'm just saying. Music is good. It's not usual Star Fox stuff, but you do get to hear usual Star Fox music, especially when you're flying in the R-Wing. As far as controls go, it takes a little while to get used to them because, again, you're expecting to play a Star Fox game, but once you do get used to it, it's not a problem. A lot of the same returning characters come back, you know, the annoying Slippy Toad, which he steals a lot in this, Peppy Hare and all that. The one who isn't in this at all is Falco, and their excuse for that is he's off doing something else. I figure what it is, they couldn't get the voice actor, or they just didn't want to put him in here. I don't know. Like I said, it wasn't even supposed to be a Star Fox game. So, there you go. There are bosses in this game, too. I don't really have that much else to say. One of my favorite characters is actually the shopkeeper's. That character's hilarious. I still can't tell if it's a he or a she, but whatever. In the end, is it worth getting? Is it worth playing and all that? Regardless if it's a Nintendo game, throw that out the window. Is it worth playing? Especially if you're expecting Star Fox. If all you want is a Star Fox game where you're flying around shooting shit, no. If that's your main thing, no. Get Star Fox Assault instead. And like I said, that game falls apart really hard when it comes to the on foot segments. Really bad, it falls apart. If there's a way to avoid those completely, then it wouldn't be as disappointing, basically. This is more disappointing, the fact that you're expecting a Star Fox game and you really don't get it, you get something different. But as it is, it's a good game. It really is. You know, you can have fun with it and play it. Just don't, you know, as soon as you remove that out of your head that you think, like, it's a Star Fox game and be flying around shooting stuff all the time, no. I mean, Andross doesn't appear in this, they don't even mention him. You know, none of that kind of stuff, the Lila system. You only get to see the main mothership, Great Fox, the big one. Only a few times you see on the map screen. You get to fly the R-Wing very rarely, pretty much. And you're going to be spending a lot of time in these different regions that, when you do finally get up there to fly, is like, holy crap, it's amazing. And you enjoy it just as much as you did if it was the whole game like that. Maybe that was intentional. I don't know. But it would have been nice to have an actual, real Star Fox game, especially since they really don't make any anymore. I mean, the most recent one is a remake on the 3DS, it's a re-release of the N64 one. So, after this was Star Fox Assault, and there really wasn't any after that, and there still is no indication of anything that they're going to make any more, you know, on the 3DS or the Wii U. So, there's that. But, you know, at least on the Virtual Console, you can get the original Star Fox, which is pretty much still the best one. So, there's that. Really, I don't have much else to say. I say go for it. It's good. I mean, it's not that expensive compared to some other Nintendo GameCube games or even some other GameCube games. You know, it's nothing up there like Fire Emblem Path of Radiance or anything. So I say you could do worse than this. I really like it. As an adventure game and all that, and as an exclusive GameCube game, you could do a lot worse than this. So I recommend it. Just keep in mind the things I said, you know. So that's all. Sorry, it went a little long, but I wanted to get all the stuff I could say about it out. So thanks for watching. I will see you next time.